So without any further ado, I'd like to introduce Jeff again from JMG. Hi, Jeff. Thanks for joining us. And he's going to walk us through and share his screen. So feel free to turn off your cameras if you just want to watch. And if you have any questions, please put them in the chat and we will do our best to answer them. If we don't get to all the questions that pop up within the meeting, we will copy them all and send out an FAQ afterwards. Go ahead, Jeff.
Hello, everybody. Everyone, Sheena, you can hear me okay? Things are good?
Things are excellent.
All right, perfect. Thank you, everyone, for taking time out of your schedule for this first of a few sessions we're going to do. Today is going to be sort of a very high level, 100,000 foot look at Raisin's Edge NXT, which is the fundraising database, the system that we're using. Raisin's Edge NXT is what we call a CRM, a constituent management database. So a CRM, constituent relationship management system. And it's all web-based. And so if you can, use Google, if you can buy a book on Amazon, if you can buy a flight on Expedia, then you can certainly use this. Raisin's Edge is it's the database that we're using, and it's an entire system built into one. So there is no longer a membership system. There's no longer a volunteer system, a donor system. There is just a system. And what that means is that everything, and I'm going to show you, everything is tied in together. So there isn't separate little pieces. For those of you that have used MWA, you may have heard, and if you haven't, then I apologize for breaking news, but it's going away as of on Friday of this week, and I'm going to be spending, while you guys are off and enjoying the holiday season, I will be converting your data all into Raisin's Edge. So the Raisin's Edge, as you can see, it's web-based. You log in through your web browser. You all would have been sent invitations to allow you to log in, but Sheena's going to review that, as she said, at the end. And so what we want to do is we want to look up somebody and we want to be able to, take a look at what a constituent looks like. Everybody is called a constituent. If you've done any political work, you know that we refer to people as constituents and constituencies. That's why MPs and MPPs have constituency offices. So it's the same sort of concept. What I'm going to do is I'm going to come over here to the magnifying glass, because this is how we search. And then basically you just type in who you're looking for. For privacy reasons, I'm keeping the names pretty generic. And so you will see, if I could spell his name right, I'm going to search for our good friend Homer Simpson, and we're going to call him up. You'll notice I just typed it in, and then I waited for the system to search and find the person. So what you want to do is try not to hit enter. When you hit enter, it will open up most likely the wrong record. So you want to just wait, pause, and then once you find it, we click on Homer Simpson. As I said, the Raisin's Edge is one complete system, so everything is tied in here. So there is no volunteer database. There is no separate system for this. There is no separate system for that. Everything is all tied together. So when I look at Homer Simpson here, you can see. Now, the other thing I should mention is, and I mentioned it briefly, privacy. So for privacy reasons, I'm using Homer Simpson. I'm keeping it very, very generic that Sheena and Emma and Joanne and I came up with. However, when it's live and you guys are in, you are only going to have access to what you're allowed to have access to. So for confidentiality reasons, there are parts of the system that you may not see. So because I have supervisor access, I have access to everything. But there may be sections that you do not see because of your role and responsibility. Then we kind of go from there, right? So everything that I say and everything that I say you can do and everything I say we can talk about remember, privacy trumps everything. So you can only do something if I, in fact, give you, or not I, but if we determine and give you rights to be able to do that. So when you're looking at a record, what you have here are tiles. These are all the different sections. Because remember I said everything is in one big picture. So you can scroll up, you can scroll down, and you can see all of it. There is no membership system. There is no volunteer system. There is no, it's all just here in the Razor's Edge, and we can do and see and act accordingly. So when I look here, I got Homer Simpson. He is a parent. And if I click under the volunteer section, I can see some volunteer information. So I can see that he did a job. He was an association volunteer. And I can see that information. There isn't as much filled in here. I didn't fill all that in, but you can start to see where we start tracking. Now, I know Evelyn and I will be going over some stuff this week, and we will be setting some stuff up for the volunteers. So there'll be a lot of good stuff that you'll be able to track and obviously report on. If I come over here, I'm gonna minimize that. I can come down to relationships, and relationships shows us all of the relationships that we have for this person. So you can see we've got Marge, who's his wife, and then we've got Maggie, Lisa, and Bart, who are the children, son and daughter. Daughters. And again, I'm going to bounce over to Lisa's record because Lisa signed up for a camp, and I'm going to show you how that information is in here. And then there's also, I can see here, there's the membership. So I can see that our good friend Homer is a member of the Middlesex Association. So again, you at one glance, you can see what they volunteered. You can see where they've membershiped. You can see their relationships and anything else that is applicable to you and to your job. I just realized I don't have the chat open. So I, just in case there are questions. Okay. All right, so now I want to bounce over to Lisa's record. And to do that, again, it's all web-based. I'm just going to click on Lisa's name, and it's just going to automatically take me and pop me over to Lisa's record. Now, I'm going to stop sharing for a second because Sheena is going to show you the registration form that Lisa filled out. Then we're going to see what it looks like as it comes in on the record.
We showed this to you before, but this is the test registration. So when Lisa fills it out, she selects the number of youth, which is single, they're single registrations, fills out all the information. You can see this is the information that would normally be captured on the participant agreement form, plus all of the consents that she is agreeing to or that her parent is agreeing to, and then clicking register. Once she registers, this screen pops up as a confirmation, and it also lists a summary of everything that she filled out in the registration form. This also gets emailed to her, and this is also what the membership coordinators and treasurers will receive as an email. So you'll, as soon as she fills this out, you'll, for your association, you will receive an automated email, provided we have your email address. And that is going to list that you have a new registration, it'll list the pertinent information, and then it'll be a summary of the application. And I'll turn it back over to you, Jeff.
Okay, perfect. So you saw the registration form. The registration form, I think everyone's seen it or had provided some feedback. So I think it's pretty close. I think there's a couple of minor little wordsmithing issues. Things that Sheena is gonna change, but it's pretty much ready to go. So the person fills out that page, answers all of the questions. You then get the email confirmation. Now, there is one other step that you do not see, and that's handled internally by us Sheena, Emma, Joanne, in order to take that information and put it into the system. So when the registrations happen, they sit in a holding tank. So if somebody did sign up and register on a Friday afternoon at 6 p.m., it may not show up into Razor's Edge until Monday. So there is a little bit of a delay depending on when the transaction was made, etc. But you rest assured, if you got that email, that means it's been there, it is captured, it is all good to go. It just, you may not see it in Razor's Edge directly. So here is Lisa, and you can see she's related to Homer. We have not linked her back to all her brothers and her mother yet. And then here is the event participate. Here is the fact that she registered. So here is that information. So what Sheena entered in on the form now translates and comes down over here. Right? And so now if I click on it, it's now going to take me into that. Again, remember, this is just the visual view. There will be reports. There will be other things, right? There will be other things that you have access to, which can then pull this information out. But again, this is just, you want to quickly pop it open. One of the things we're working on is a PDF or an Excel spreadsheet containing a lot of this information. We realize that when there's when you're at a camp, you may not have internet access, or maybe not good internet access, or you just don't have time to connect, and you just want to have it printed, you want to have it in a binder, you want to have it on your tablet. So we will be facilitating all of that information as needed. But as you can see, so here's the party information. There is Lisa. Now, these are all what we call custom fields. These are all of the questions, right? So what is the gender identity? When is her birthday? Really? You mean Patty, the emergency contact? Okay. So Patty is the, I guess Sheena doesn't know Patty's last name. So Patty is the emergency contact there. And then there's her phone number. And oh, of course, you made the aunts the emergency contact. They don't want to call the parents? All right, Sheena. All right. I guess Barter or Marge didn't. That makes sense that Homer would not want to be the emergency contact for Lisa. Totally makes sense. So here's that contact information again as I cycle through. There is the doctor information. Obviously, she's vegetarian. She's consented to the information. And then you've got all the other information that's needed there. So we are capturing all of the information. The other thing to mention about Razor's Edge and about the data is if it's in the system, we can get it out. If you don't know how to get it out, that's okay. Sheena is a pro. Sheena knows how to get everything out of there. So no worries. And then what she doesn't know, she's obviously going to come to me. So as long as the data is being captured, we can get that information out, right? And again, I can quickly go back to Lisa's record. Again, just single click. It's just like using Google. Some do say Razor's Edge is kind of like a rabbit hole. You can get down and dig it into some records. You can always go back to the home screen and it shows you which records you have open. So if you've lost Homer, you can always come back and I can click on the home screen and quickly get back to Dad if I need to. And then I can also see the rest of the family. I can quickly get back into Lisa's record and I can do with whatever I see fit. I'm gonna stop here. Is there any questions? A lot of chitter chatter going on, but I don't see any questions.
So a couple questions just popped up. So how do leaders access this information? So leaders will be supplied this information from the membership coordinators. And who has access to this? Only treasurers and membership coordinators. So at the time being, it's only treasurers and membership coordinators, and then screening contacts will have access to volunteer records.
Awesome. If people do not have access, then what we can do is we can facilitate whatever the needs are via reports, PDFs, things like that. So everything is accessible in the database to produce reports, to produce, you know, sort of whatever is needed. So there's a number of things that we can do in terms of custom reporting, PDF reports, Excel. There's a number of things that can be done. So there's we can look at facilitating some of that and making sure that whoever needs that information has access to it.
And I just got another private message. So a one-page list, and it's asking, do membership coordinators and treasurers get a one-page list to send to leaders, or do they need to send each record individually? And the answer to that is that we would like, or we're going to set up so that they can pull a one-page list with all of the information that is in the registration to send to the leaders. We just don't have all of the data to pull those reports yet, because we're at a point now where we have to move everything from MWA into Razor's Edge so that we can build out all of those reports. And that's not happening until Friday. So that's that work that Jeff's going to be doing over the holidays, and that we'll be able to show everybody in January. And membership coordinators, yes. So we're asking that the membership coordinators, because some of the role has changed a little bit, you won't have to enter every single youth that comes into the club. So we're asking that, yes, that you pull those reports by club and send them to the leaders. And like you said, that could either be printed or it can be pulled out and emailed.
Again, some of this stuff, for privacy reasons, we're not demonstrating. Once everything is live, we can then, with as things are needed, we can work with the individuals to make sure that the correct information is pulled. I could pull some lists, I could do some things, but for privacy reasons, we're not doing that today. So in the new year, when we have additional sessions, that and we've got all the MWA data in there, we'll be able to generate and produce a variety of lists, et cetera.
And Susan, thank you for asking about the club projects. So they're actually going to live under the membership tab. And again, that's one of the functionalities. So right after we jump off this call, I'm going to be booking probably at least two more training sessions for the first couple weeks of January that will also be recorded. And one of which is to cover club entry. And that's another one that, because we haven't stopped using MWA yet, that functionality hasn't been able to, we can't demonstrate that functionality in Razor's Edge as it stands right now. When members register, will they choose a club they are affiliated with? So they will choose an association, and we're asking that club registration is still done at the local level. That was a lot of the feedback that we received this summer. Clubs wanted to maintain, or sorry, associations wanted to maintain that personal connection. Sorry, lots of questions popping in, trying to keep up with them. So they will not choose on their registration what club they're affiliated with. That will be done at the association level. And then once they're registered for a club, the membership coordinator will just enter that on their profile. Shauna, each person will not have a public 4-H profile like they do now. What we found in the website rebuild was that very few people were making use of that function. So we have not continued it for the time being. When giving the livestock coordinator membership verification, can a list of and Diane, do you mean just the livestock club members within a certain association? Yes, that would be a list that you'd be able to pull. Will the awards coordinators have access to this database? Lorraine, we haven't actually discussed that yet with the team here. Right now, we're focused on getting the year started with membership coordinators, treasurers, and screening contacts. But as Jeff mentioned, he does have a meeting with Evelyn this week to discuss further build out of the volunteer module. So I would assume that if you don't have, if there's positions that we haven't outlined having access that will require access, then yes, they will be created. And Shauna, yes, if people are applying for scholarships, you'll be able to pull all the information within their record and supply it to them. And Mary Lynn, that's a great question. There's not a substantial leg, but yes, if a member's paid online and they have the confirmation email, they can absolutely do that.
I've done a number of, when my kids are old teenagers now and now are just lazy and don't do anything, but when they were younger and I used to put them in camps, sometimes I'd register, but I'd always have that registration email. So if I wasn't on the printed list, because sometimes that happened before and I registered late because that's who I am, but I would have the confirmation email. So I would often do that, you know, back in the olden days, you know, when we used to go to things and do camps and stuff like that. So not uncommon and not unheard of just to be able to use that registration, because they would be getting something in their email. So again, if they registered, you know, the morning of the event and it was a Saturday, then, you know, it may not get popped into the database. So, and you may have already done a report by then. So,
but you will have that email, you will have the copy of the confirmation as well. So you will have, and actually I can show it if you want to give me a chance.
Yeah, I can do that. Yeah, sure.
Okay, so this is the email that that they will get, or a version of this email. This is the test one. What comes in your inbox as one of the people who are notified when someone registers is very similar to this. You won't get this sort of information at the top, but you'll get a summary of the person's name and then a summary of their entry. So even if it's not directly in Raiser's Edge, membership coordinators will have sort of that first step of verification that yes, they have inputted it and you've received it. And if you walk away and think of 100 other questions after the fact, don't hesitate to email us. We're going to continue to build out our list of FAQs, and we're going to address a lot more in ongoing sessions. We thought it would be good to start with an introduction to what the profiles look like. And then after we bring all the data over from the MWA. Yes, Shauna, the summary of medical info will be in the confirmation email.
Everything that is collected shows up in the confirmation email. And I don't know if you can show the form again really quickly, but there is a number of required fields that they have to fill in, and then there are some optional ones as well.
Yeah. So you'll see some of them are optional. So we're gonna continue to use the 4-H Ontario ID numbers where they had been assigned before. And then new constituent numbers, I think, will be created as we move ahead. But yeah, there are fields marked optional. So, and again, this is a test form. So there are a few things in here that are not necessarily perfect. Diane, if a family doesn't do online activities or trust online payments. So we've actually addressed that a couple times in the town hall that we did a couple weeks ago. And so although we are asking that wherever possible, people are registering online, we do realize that there's a period of transition. We are going to supply an additional page for people that are unable to complete a credit card payment. And if they need our assistance, you can direct them directly to the 4-H Ontario staff and we'll assist them with their registration. They will still have to complete the online form, but we'll arrange for alternate payment either by e-transfer or by debit, I think. Sharon, I'm glad you got a sample of the confirmation email. Sorry that you were still on that. I was working on building up the forms, but I'm glad to hear it works. Yes, Deanna, thank you for your question. Is this program compatible with iPads? It is mobile friendly, so you can access it on any device. And Brenda, thank you. Yes, I will definitely speak to I will speak to Evelyn and Joanne about the awards coordinators. That's something that hadn't been brought up to me, so I will make sure that that's on our list. And Lorraine, yes, you will be able to see people's 4-H history as much as we have in the MWA, but there are some particular situations where members' history either wasn't captured correctly or the dates weren't entered. So whatever we have historically will be moved over. Is allergy optional? Yes, it is. It's optional in case they don't have an allergy. And yes, Lorraine, if someone's family status changes, you will be able to make changes in the database. And yes, they will be able to be listed as inactive. And the 4-H Ontario staff team is also looking at policy for record keeping. So there will be sort of like a length of time on how long we hold on to records. We will have historical data and backup, but so that we don't end up with excess records in the database, there will be a policy, like an operational policy created. And yes, payment will go directly to 4-H Ontario. Dale is working with Jeff and his team to set up an automatic split so that if your association charges more than the provincial fee, it automatically goes to your association. And if they charge less, then Dale will know how to generate the invoice for the difference. And I'm guessing, George and Dawn, that is for the allergies, and we can certainly look at that. And that's the sort of thing, like, if I will send this link out as a test, and please have a look at it. And those are the things that, or sorry, not that one, but the confirmation email. Those are the things that if you feel like an NA would be better, because in your experience, people may have just, they don't think to answer it, happy to do that. And yes, Susan, we will be keeping historical records. It's just how we keep them, because there are concerns with keeping records indefinitely until the end of time. It's really not best practice. So we'll be making sure that we use things properly. There is an alumni section in the database, and we will be working. We've actually got a new alumni form up on the website, and we're capturing that information properly as well.
Susan, just to kind of expand on that, although MWA will be shut down as of Friday, we will have the whole backup of the entire database. And we will have all of that data available to us. So come later on, if there's something that we didn't bring over initially, but it's deemed now important that we maybe didn't realize it was important, or we forgot about it, or whatever it might be, then yes, we can certainly bring it. So it's not like we don't, it's not like it's gonna go away. We will have backups of that data. So if something is there and we didn't bring it across initially, let me rephrase that. If I don't bring it across over initially, then it's always going to be available, and we can always, you know, dump all of that information in. I do know that the awards information is coming across, and it will be in there. I know that for a fact. I got a thumbs up from Susan, so that's good. So just answering Lorraine's question, not about the volunteer access, but I tell you, all the awards is going to be in there, and so we'll be able to generate a report or whatever it is we happen to need.
Yep, and add and track the new ones as well.
Yeah, exactly.
And you can see Emma just posted a link again to the town hall recording. I know there was an issue with the one we sent in the e-news this month. So please check it out if you haven't had a chance yet. It's there was a lot of really good conversation there as well.
Sorry, I'm just gonna jump on for a second. Lorraine, I see your question about awards given to the members. Are you meaning awards that the association specifically gives, or are you meaning awards that they receive from 4-H Ontario? Because the ones from 4-H Ontario are actually, I will update those. I update those every year, usually in the new year. So those should already be in the database under each member. So that will continue. I'm just wondering if you mean specific ones from the association.
Being specific ones from the association, since we do recognize different achievements.
Okay, thanks.
So that's not something that we've looked at, Lorraine, but I can speak to Jeff about, I think once we get the data over, we'll have a look. The nice thing about Razor's Edge is, unlike MWA, we're not limited with what we're using right now. Like, there's so much functionality that we can build into it. So if there's something that you really need to capture that you're finding isn't in there, likely we can find a way to do that for you.
The Razor's Edge is the most popular program used by nonprofits throughout the world. I'm not sure where everybody lives, but your local hospital probably uses it. If you were to go in and make a donation, there's a good chance it's in a Razor's Edge database. So there are, thousands of users, hundreds of organizations in Canada that use it. And like Sheena said, the opportunities are endless. There is no limit. Plus, you know, Sheena, Joanne, Emma can just make up new things and create it. MWA was a custom built fixed program. And so if things needed to be added, there was usually a huge cost involved to that, whereas there is no cost to this. So if there is something that needs to be done around local awards, for example, or anything else, or if somebody else needs to track, you know, you want to start tracking shirt size or anything else, we can quickly add that and can be added to a form tracked in the database and go from there. So a lot of flexibility, a lot of things, a lot of things can be done within reason, not to bog down the 4-H Ontario team, but, things can be done a lot easier and simpler than in the MWA world.
Perfect. Good to know. Thank you, Lorraine. And same again, like once we get into using it, if anybody has thoughts or ideas on how to improve those things or things that you want to track that you haven't, we want to work with you to make sure that the system works the best it can for everyone going forward. So it's going to be an ongoing evolving project. And so, will the participant info be able to be entered here too, also for show catalogs? Oh, the PAFE info.
I think that's Project Animal Identification.
Thank you, sorry. No, I think we're going to continue to use, Joanne, help me out. What's the program we use for that?
I know, I'm drawing a blank too.
That's awesome. Thank you, Evelyn. Thanks, guys. Everybody's answering me now. Oh my goodness, I can't believe I couldn't get that out of my mouth. Thank you, everybody. Yes, we're going to continue to use Assist Expo for that, so that's housed in the one place. And that's much the same as we weren't using MWA to track that info. So that'll continue in Assist Expo. So I'm gonna say now, I just wanna save a few minutes to walk through that Blackbaud registration. So I'm gonna stay
just in case. So I'll let you continue.
Thanks, Jeff. Again, any questions after this, please just send me an email or reach out and I'll do my best to get an answer to you. I want to show you the Raises Edge login process for those of you who have had trouble. So we did send out invites to anyone whose email. Oh, sorry, I'm just gonna answer Carla's question. So Carla, yes, if your association sends me the information that you'd like, because I'm creating individual registration forms for each association, happy to tailor that confirmation email so that it's customized to the association. There are some things that have to be included from the provincial side, but if there's information that you want to include in there, happy to put it in. So I'm just gonna share. Oh, wait, I didn't share my sound. One of these days I will share a video and remember to click all of the boxes before I share it. So we sent out invites to create your Raiser's Edge login. So it's an invite to join Blackbaud. And I just wanna make sure that everybody gets a chance to have a look at this. Many people, because I can see on my list who has looked and accepted the invitation and who hasn't. So, and we've gotten a few emails saying that it wasn't working or people didn't receive it. So you just wanna run through the video again. And then if you're having trouble, if you wanna stay on the line after the call, if there's not too many of us, they can try and help us now, or we can arrange a time where I can have a meeting with you to go through it.
Saying you have been accepted
Sorry, I'm gonna restart that. And I hope everybody can hear it. Just wave at me if you can. Oh, you can. Emma's saying yes. Awesome. Okay.
So you'll get an email saying you have been accepted to, you've been invited to Blackbaud. So you're gonna click the link and then you're gonna click accept invitation. And it's gonna take you to a login screen. Now the login is gonna, you don't have a login yet, you have to create it. So you're gonna click the button, need an account, sign up. And then you're going to enter in your email information. Now you're going to enter a password. Enter your name. You're going to click sign up. So then you're going to be able to go back into your email. And you'll have an authentication where you have to confirm your email. It's going to redirect you to use this ID. And then it will take you to your Blackbaud home screen.
Okay, so if you did not receive the initial invite, please send me an email and I will confirm that we have the correct email for you for one, and that you're listed as the correct contact for the association. Because I see a couple of people telling me that they didn't receive the first email. The second one is to remember that when you do click that invitation link, you make sure that you click on I do not have a login or create a login. You don't try and just log in with your email. And then the other thing I want to point out is that these are time sensitive invites, so they will expire. So if you try it, and I think they're 30 days, so if you try it and it's expired, you have to send me an email so that I can send you a new invite. And I guess, are there any other questions? So if you, I guess to, we will, And thank you, Evelyn. Yes. So please do check junk or spam folders. Susan, that was what I was going to say next. So Blackbaud gives you access to Razor's Edge NXT, and that is, let me sign out and I can show you. That was the next part that I was going to show. So once you get the confirmation email, it's for the video, and you click confirm email, it's going to take you to this screen. So then you can sign in. Now, it probably won't take you directly to NXT. Am I right in that, Jeff? When you're logging in for the first time. I think it'll take you to the Blackbaud homepage. So you know what we'll do is that Emma and I will create a second video so that we can show you what happens from after you've got your login. I just want to make sure that there's not an overwhelming amount of information in one video so people don't get stuck watching 20 minutes that they don't need. So we'll do a second video of accessing that homepage of Razor's Edge, and then we can include what Jeff has walked us through here with what the constituent profiles look like. And I've lost my chat window somewhere. And we will, and yeah, if please do send me a direct email if you haven't gotten through, because I'll lose the chat after we leave this meeting. I'm getting a few private messages.